Added unto the gospel of God. Concerning his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh. By whom we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name. To all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all, that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. Father, we pray that you will bless our study today. Give us wisdom that we may understand your word and be encouraged, Lord, by the truths behind this. I pray that you will help us, Lord, be better as we study your word. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you very much. So we are going to start a series of studies in the book of Romans. The book of Romans is a very important book when it comes to faith. Martin Luther claimed his turnaround because of the book of Romans when he read it, and saw that the just shall live by faith. And then after reading this, he posted his a protest against Catholicism at the Diet of Worms, and that started the movement that we call Protestantism. But sad to say, he, I believe, did not understand the whole of the book of Romans, because in his succeeding actions, there are also some persecutions that were what we call a carryover from the Catholicism where he came from. And he also sought to control other people to believe what he is teaching them. But the book of Romans is a book that is filled with doctrines, basic doctrines that is very important in the life of a Christian. If we will understand the doctrines that were mentioned in the book of Romans, then we are going to have a very solid foundation and a strong Christian life. Almost all of the keywords in Christianity and doctrine are found in this book. And perhaps the reason for this is because Paul did not reach this place when he wrote this particular letter, when he wrote this letter to the Romans. So he actually gave them a plethora of doctrines that I believe he taught all the churches that he had established during his missionary journey. So that is the reason why maybe the book of Romans is filled with nuggets that we can actually mine, so that we can have a better understanding of salvation, understanding of sin, understanding on how to live the Christian life, and understanding how to live for the glory of God. So we will try to study the book of Romans in detail, and would to God that he will give us wisdom so that we can understand this particular book. In verse number 1, the Bible says, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God. So the first thing that we can notice is that Paul is a servant of Jesus Christ. Amen. So that is a very important declaration, because most people wanted to exalt themselves. But Paul is in the breed of John the Baptist, wherein every time he speaks something, it is for the increase of Jesus and the diminishing of himself. So he described himself as the servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. So what does he mean by this particular statement? The word servant is from the Greek word doulos. That is the Greek word of this word. It is used 119 verses in the New Testament. And it is a very wonderful word that is filled with truth from the Word of God. It is a word of desire. So doulos was used of a person who voluntarily served others. You see, if you are a servant, most of the time you are forced to be a servant. You are bought to be a servant. You must be hauled from some place and then thrown into another place in order to be sold to become a servant. So most people despise being a servant. It is not going to be a choice. But in the case of the Apostle Paul, this word has a meaning of desire. He wants to be a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. It was his choice to become a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. This particular word means he was a bond slave. A bond slave is what we call a willing slave. It is a slave not forced to become a slave, but a person who voluntarily wants to become a slave. Look at Exodus chapter 21, verses 5 to 6. Exodus chapter 21, verses 5 to 6. This is what the Bible says. And if the servant shall plainly say, I love my master, my wife, my children, and I will not go out free. So he says, I'm going to be a servant for life. I'm not going to go out free. Because in the Bible, in the system of the Israelites or Jewish tradition, there will come a time on the year of Jubilee that all servants will be freed. But a bond servant will choose to remain a servant. Then his master shall bring him unto the judges, showing him his desire. He shall also bring him to the door, so that he will say or tell people his desire, or unto the doorpost, and his master shall bore his ear through with an awl, and he shall serve him forever. So bubutasan na yung tenga niyan, signifying that he is a servant forever of that master, and he was a servant in a voluntary way. So it is not something that is forced into a person. That is why doulos is a word of desire. Number two, it is a word of dedication. It is a word of dedication. A doulos is one bound to a master with cords so strong that only death can break it. Meaning to say, as long as the master is living, he will remain a servant. That is why being a servant of Christ is a lifelong servitude. Because the one that we are serving will never die. You see, that's why it is a word of dedication. He was forever on duty for God. You see, in other instances, like in Egypt, there are what you call servants. They are not bond slave, but they are slave of a maybe tyrannical master. And when, for example, a Pharaoh or children of a Pharaoh died, and he will be put inside a pyramid to be buried there forever, all the servants will accompany the dead body of that person, and they will serve him even though he was already dead, until they die inside the pyramid or inside the tomb. So that is what a servant is. The cord is so strong that only death can separate him or her from his or her master. So it was a word of dedication. That's why when you say, I dedicate my life to the Lord Jesus Christ, it is a one-time, forever decision. But you know, sometimes, sad to say, we dedicate our lives to the Lord every Sunday. And then we take it back, comes Monday until Saturday, and then rededicate it on a Sunday. And then do that vicious cycle in our life until we found out that we are about, at the end of our lives, not really doing anything for God. So it is a word of dedication. Not only that, but this is something that is very important. It was a word of delight. Paul delighted to become a servant. And nobody will be delighted to become a servant. If you're going to look at the nature of what a slave is. But then again, ladies and gentlemen, if you have a master like the Lord Jesus Christ, you will opt to be his servant than to be what you call a boss of other people or a master of other people, because you cannot find an employer better or greater than the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. So that's why Paul, when he says, I am a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ, it carries the feeling of being delighted. Because in the words of servant, there is a what you call the slaves of the empire. They are servants, but they are slave of the king or the ministers during the time. So even though they are servants, they occupy a higher position compared to other servants. How much more that Paul is a servant of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Amen? That is why there is a delight when the Apostle Paul described himself as the servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. But primarily, the word doulos is insignificant. If a lay person or a normal person will look at it, because when they say that you are a doulos, not in a Christian perspective, it means that you are not even a person. You are considered a property, a thing, and you have no right, but only to serve your master for the rest of your life. But if we're going to do it to the Lord Jesus Christ, it is good to be insignificant, because when we are nothing, then that's the time that we're going to be something for God. Amen? The Lord Jesus Christ says, for without me, you can do nothing. So it is better to become nobody for Jesus, so that Jesus can make us a somebody because of the grace that he has bestowed in our lives. So it is a word of, number one, desire. Number two, dedication. And it is a word of delight. So that is what we can take from that. So meaning to say that Paul was a willing slave of Jesus Christ, who existed only to do God's will and not his own. Because as a servant, you have no right. So now that Paul is a servant of Jesus, Paul now has no rights but to serve the Lord Jesus Christ for the rest of his life. So Paul considered himself on duty for the Lord Jesus Christ always. His life is at the disposal of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is why, listen to me, we have no right to decide for ourselves, but our right is to obey the commandments of God. That's why we said, I want to become a missionary and I want to go to that place. Question, is that the place where God wants you to be? Because if that is only your desire, then you are acting like a master and you're not acting like a servant. If you will look at the life of the Apostle Paul, he wanted to go to this place, and then he will say, but the Holy Spirit forbid me, and he directed me to go to another place. So that is how it is to become a servant. Your life is at the disposal of the Lord Jesus Christ. So Pastor, how can I know if that is where God is leading me? Go deeper into the Word of God. Exercise obedience. And when you do that, then God will open doors for you. Because if you are not deep into the Word of God, and if your life is not in a total obedience to the Word of God, then there is always a danger that you will do your plan or accomplish your plan instead of the plan of God. But when Paul made himself a servant, then God said, I am going to be your master, and I am going to direct you, and your life will be lived according to my will. And we can see that in the life of the Apostle Paul, he was able to glorify God. That's why before he died, he says, I have finished my course. It was the course given to him by God. And our God is a faithful God. He will guide us all the way. if we are going to serve Him with all our might. Look at Galatians chapter 6, verse number 17. Galatians 6, 17. The Apostle Paul declared, "From henceforth let no man trouble me, for I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus Christ." What is the significance of this? You know, in olden times, during the time of the Lord Jesus Christ, or the time of the Apostle Paul, if you are a servant or if you are a soldier, usually you bear the mark of your leader or your master. Like for example, in our time, if you are a ranger, you have a tattoo. All rangers have what you call a tattoo inscribed on their shoulder so they can show that. Or if you are a member of a gang, like Sigi Sputnik, you have a mark showing that you belong to that particular group. And during the time of the Lord Jesus Christ and the time of the Apostle Paul, it is the same thing. If you are a servant, you usually bear the mark of your master. It's either inscribed or cut into your skin, so that wherever you are, they will see who you belong to. Or if you are a soldier, you usually put the mark of your commanding officer to your body so that they know in what regiment you belong to. That is how they do it. And the same thing with the servants during that time. Parang kukuha sila nung mainit na ano, iba brand sa'yo. You call that stigmata. That is a mark that will remain with you forever. So you are going to be a servant or a member of that particular company, so as a soldier, for the rest of your life. You cannot erase it anymore. And Paul is saying, I bear the mark of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that is something that cannot be erased. That is something that I am not going to abdicate. That is something that I will not turn my back to. But that is something that I will do for the rest of my life. So Paul says, stop troubling me, because I will serve God until the day that I will die. Amen? So that is the significance of the marks that the Apostle Paul is telling his people when he says that I bear the mark of the Lord Jesus Christ. So why did the Apostle Paul do this or declare this? Because in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 to 20, he says, we are bought with a price. And if we are bought with a price, then we do not belong to ourselves anymore, but we belong to the person who bought us. That's why he said, what? It was a word of amazement. Know ye not? Hindi niyo ba alam? That your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own. That is a very powerful statement. Ye are not your own. So listen, we have no right to use this body for our own gratification. Because it says, ye are not your own, for ye are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. So we are merely stewards of this body. Amen. We are merely stewards of this spirit. But most of the time, we direct our own steps going against the will of God. Amen? Kaya pagka Sunday, dito ka pinapupunta ng Panginoon. You have no right to go to any other place. You have no right to do any other thing. You should be or must be in your place where the owner wants you to be. Eh, hindi eh. Hindi, gusto ko rito. Bakit? Buhay ko to. Sabi sa'yo, pag kinuha yan, magagawa ka ba? He says, sometimes we boast that this is our life. If God wanted to take that life, you cannot do anything about it. It only shows that this life does not belong to us. It is a borrowed life. It is a life entrusted unto us. So we need to understand that we are a servant and we belong to God. But you see, the difference is this. If you are a servant of a tyrant, you're going to have a hard life, hard labor. You are going to experience all the negative things in life, negative circumstances, painful existence. But it is very different if you are a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? So, what are you if you are a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ? Number one, you are separated. You are a separated servant. Romans chapter 1 verse 1, our text, the Bible says, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God. So we are separated. To what? Unto the gospel. So our business as a servant is to preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Is to preach the good news that was given to man. It is to proclaim the salvation that God has purchased on the cross of Calvary. It is not our business to preach about politics. It is not our business to preach about anything else in this world. But our business is to preach about the gospel, to preach about Jesus, to preach about the word of God, and preach things that will glorify our God. Amen? Amen. But the sad thing is that we are already separated, but we are separating from our separation. Yun ang problema. Iniba ka na, umiba ka pa. Kaya iba ka talaga. Hindi ba? That is our problem. We are separated unto the gospel and we are doing other things than the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we need to understand that there is a purpose why we are a servant. We are separated unto something. And that something is what we call the gospel. Not only that, but number two, we are sealed. Look at Ephesians chapter 1, verse number 13. We are sealed. It is a mark of ownership. In whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. In whom also, after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. This is the assurance of our salvation. This means that we belong to God. If there is something, and there is stamped there, the property of Pastor Joel Madlang Awa, it means it belongs to me. If it happens to be in your house, there is a problem. It is either you borrowed it or you stole it from me. But it belongs to me because it bore my seal. You see, our salvation is this. The Bible says in John chapter 10 that we are in the hands of the Father. Amen? And no man can pluck us out from the Father's hand. The Bible says that we are in the hands of the Son. And then, that is the assurance of our salvation. But you know, there are people who will try to find something wrong. They said that, don't you know that the Lord Jesus Christ was crucified on the cross of Calvary, so therefore there is a hole in his hand. So what happens that even though you're in the hands of the Lord Jesus Christ, it happens that you are placed in that hole, so you will fall down. So you are not saved anymore. But the Bible says, we are sealed with the Spirit. And if we are sealed, we already have that mark of ownership. We belong to God. So wherever we fall, we still belong to God. Amen? Amen. Of course, that is not the exegesis, but that is how to answer people who would like to find fault or something wrong in the Word of God. So we are sealed. We belong to God. Amen. Amen. We belong to the Lord. So it is so sad that even though we already belong to God, we still serve the devil, in whom we have nothing to do, because he did not do anything good for us and to us. But the sad thing is that we voluntarily serve him than serving God. So we are sealed. We belong to the Lord Jesus Christ. His image and mark are upon our lives. If you say that you're a Christian, you belong to Christ. If you say that you are a Satanist, you belong to Satan. So are you a Satanist or are you a Christian? So if we belong to God, then we need to serve God in our lives. Amen? Amen. Not only that, but number three, we are supported. Philippians 4:19. The servant of the Lord Jesus Christ is not only separated, not only sealed, but supported. But my God shall supply all your need according to His riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Amen. So as a bondslave of the Lord Jesus Christ, we have a support coming from Him. God will always take care of us. Amen. David said, I have been young and now I'm old. But then he said that I did not even see a servant of God or a child of God begging for bread. Why? Because God promised a supply for all of our needs. But you see, so many Christians are not satisfied because they are going for their wants instead of their needs. If you give them 3110 cell phone, they will even laugh at that cell phone. And they said, I want a Samsung S10X. If it is not updated, if it is not brand new, then I don't like it. I'm not satisfied. Why? Because you want what you are going for your wants, not for your needs. God will give you the food that we need in order to survive and be nourished. But then we wanted fancy food. Like fancied. And all of these things, you see? So we are going for what we want, but God promised that He will supply all of our needs. Amen? So just trust the Lord and be contented, and then God will satisfy you according to His will. So that is why the Apostle Paul lacked nothing when he was in his missionary journey. But Pastor, I don't believe you. Why? Because the Apostle Paul worked. So how can you say that God supplied this need? Yes, by giving him two hands, God supplied the needs of the Apostle Paul so that he can use it so that the supply of God will flow through those hands of the Apostle Paul. Amen? So the strength, the faculty that God has given us are all a supply for our needs. But you see, sometimes the problem is this. I'm going to serve God and you take care of my needs. Now, ladies and gentlemen, you serve God whatever it takes. If you need to tent mate. If you need to go on deputation, go on deputation. If you need to work, work. What is important is you are serving God, and in whatever way, God is supplying your needs. Do not just wait. Because you see, sometimes the problem is this. You will see some servants of God or pastors or ministers that are not working, but their needs are being supplied. And you said, I want to be like that. You see, it's not always like this. We have gone through a process in life before we receive this kind of status in life. It may happen, it may not happen. What is important is you want to serve God. And if it is your desire to serve God, it doesn't matter what may come in or what may come out. What's important is that you are serving God in your life. And if you're serving God, God knows what to do. Amen? Amen. You do your part and let God do His part. Number four, a servant is strengthened. 2 Timothy 4:17. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse number 17. Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me. You see? The Apostle Paul experienced so many things in life that his life was almost always in danger. He said, I die all the day long. But he said, in those moments, God stood with me and God strengthened me, that by me the preaching might be fully known. Why is the strength coming? Why is God standing with us? So that we can do His will, and that is to preach the gospel. Amen? So the preaching might be fully known, and that all the Gentiles might hear. And I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion. What's the reason? Not for Paul to just continue living, but for the Apostle Paul to continue doing the will of God. So listen, if we are living and not doing the will of God, we are not actually living. We are wasting this life. Because the only reason why there is strength, the only reason why God is with us, the only reason why He is protecting us is so that we can fulfill His will in our lives. So that is why, ladies and gentlemen, if all you want to accomplish are things for yourself, you are wasting your life. Why? Because the things that you want to have here, as I have said before, and I will say it again, is already reserved in heaven. Why do you still have to waste all your effort, your time in amassing something that we have plenty of waiting for us in heaven? God says, this is not the time for that. This is the time to serve me. This is the time to reach the lost. This is the time to preach the gospel. This is the time to glorify God, because the night will come when no man can work. And we are going to be in heaven and we'll be in bliss together with the Lord Jesus Christ. So while we are waiting for that day, work, for the night is coming. Amen. So that is the reason why Paul was strengthened by God, not for himself. Uulitin ko. Hindi para sa kanyang sarili. Kapatid, hindi ka matalino para sa sarili mo. Hindi ka malakas para sa sarili mo. Hindi ka magaling para sa sarili mo. Hindi ka maganda para sa sarili mo. Hindi ka rin pangit para sa sarili mo. Hindi ka may karamdaman para sa sarili mo. Lahat ng meron tayo para sa kaluwalhatian ng Diyos, at gawin natin yung kalooban niya. That is the only reason why. Why? Because we are a bond slave. We are a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we are strengthened. And not only that, we are secured. 2 Timothy 4:18. Look at what the Bible says. And the Lord shall deliver me from every evil work, and will preserve me unto his heavenly kingdom, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. So we are already secured. So don't worry. Amen. Don't worry. That's why you read the whole of Matthew chapter 6, and it will tell you not to worry. Because even the sparrow will not fall down to the ground without the knowledge of our Heavenly Father. Even the grass in the field that will be burned tomorrow are being adorned by God with an adornment that even Solomon in his grandeur did not even experience. So these are the things. How much more, he said, ye that are God's children, O ye of little faith. So why spend your life worrying? Spend your life serving God. Amen? Because God knew, or God knows what He's doing. We are already preserved for His kingdom. So we can see that Paul had a servant's attitude. And this is the key reason why God used him. And this is going to be the reason why God will use us. Servant's attitude. That's why I read on Facebook that he's wondering, why is it there are so many leadership conferences and there are so few servants conference, when all of us are servants and not masters? That is why in our Baptist circle, we are filled with leaders who wanted to be followed than followers who will become a leader because they know how to follow in the first place. So that is now becoming our problem. We do not have what we call a servant's spirit or a servant's heart. We are a minister of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? Look at 1 Corinthians 3:5. This is what the Apostle Paul says. 1 Corinthians 3:5. Who then is Paul? Sino ba ako? Because you see, these Corinthian people are, they prepare respect persons They said, I am of Paul, I am of Apollos, I am of etc., etc., I am of Christ, and whoever may come their way. So Paul says, who then is Paul? Sino ba ako? I am nothing. Who is Apollos? He is nothing. But we are ministers by whom ye believed, even as the Lord gave to every man. Do you know the word minister here? It came from a word that is so derogatory that when you describe yourself a minister, it pertains to those people who are in the lowest part of the ship. And when you are rowing or a rower on the lowest part of the ship, that is the most dangerous place to be, because you can die anytime because of waves and other circumstances that you are going to experience while you are at the lowest deck of the ship. So Paul is saying, we are the low of the lowest. We are the lowest of the low. So who are we? Why are you now saying that I am of Paul? Who is Paul? Why are you now saying I am of Apollos? Who is Apollos? That is why, ladies and gentlemen, if you are a respecter of person, you are an idolater. Ah, hindi. Ang pastor ko si ano. Kaya, who is he? Oh, ang pastor ko si Joel Madlangawa. Si Joel Madlangawa? Ang pantot nga ng apelido. Sino ba yan? Oh, ang pastor ko si Abante. Sino ba si Abante? Oh, ang pastor ko si Sauco. Sino ba si Sauco? Oh, ang pastor ko si Nable. Sino ba si Nable? Sino ba tayo? Wala. It is all about Jesus and none of us. Oh, tapos sasabihin mo, di mo ba ako kilala? Eh, hindi kita dapat makilala. Gusto ko makilala ang Panginoon, amen? You see, if you are a servant, there will be no pride there. The problem is we do not have a servant spirit or a servant's heart. That is why we are filled with pride. You see, that word minister came from the word diakonos, where the word deacon came from. That is why deacons are not the leaders of the church. They are not the masters of the church. They are the servants of the church. Kaya pag marumi ang inodoro nyo, tawag kayo ng deacon. Amen. Yan ang servant's heart. Dahil pag tinawag nyo, tatawag siya ng iba. Yan. So yun ang ibig sabihin nun. We are here to minister, not to be ministered unto. For even the Son of Man came not to be ministered, but to minister unto, and to give His life a ransom for many. Even the Lord Jesus Christ served while He was here on earth. There are only few instances that He allowed Himself to be ministered unto, but it was during the time where there is a what we call eternal significance. Like when Mary poured a spikenard on His feet and cleansed it with her hair. It has a significance on the death, the burial, and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Those are the only times that He allowed Himself to be ministered by people. But almost all of the time, He ministered to them. But you see now, in our time, if you are a full-time worker of the church, if you are a deacon, if you are a pastor, you demand people to serve you. We don't demand service. It must be given freely by people. And you appreciate when you are being served. You see, there are ministers that I do not understand. They will come to a church and then people will see them. They are maybe holding an attaché case and people will not get that from them. And then when they stand behind the pulpit, he will say, you are all ungrateful. My. Why? You did not even take my attaché case and carry it from me. If you want somebody to carry your attaché case, you hire somebody or don't bring it with you so that you're not going to be inconvenienced. But we are servants of God. So if you have a servant's heart, then a pastor is not going to be cocky. When you are cocky, mayabang. Parang manok. Di ba yung manok pag magaanan? Mga ganun yun, nagyayabang na yun, tutumba na ako. O hindi ba, ganun yung ginagawa nun. Kaya pag magyayabang ka, matutumba ka eh. O hindi ba, yung peacock, pag ginanun niya na yung ano niya, hindi ba? O tapos, gaganun-ganun na yun, o, buti hindi ako natumba ngayon. Mag-ano na yun, magyayabang na yun. Nag-a-attract na yun. Nag-a-attract na. Meaning to say, if you're a pastor, you do not attract people to yourself. You attract people to the Lord Jesus Christ. Kaya, kapatid, pag pastor ka at sumisikat ka, malungkot ka. Mali ang nagagawa mo. If you are a pastor and you are becoming popular, you need to be sad because what you're doing may be wrong. Why is it that people are being attracted to you than attracted to the Lord Jesus Christ? You ask that question to yourself. Now, if you are popular not because of your own doing, but because you serve God faithfully, so be it. But you give the glory to God. You say, hindi pa rin yung, well, magagawa ko. Naglingkod ako sa Panginoon, ang totoo na kaya sikat ako. Hindi ganoon. Actually, pag sinabi pa nga, you're doing a good job, you tell them, no, to God be the glory. It is all because of Him. Without Him, I can do nothing. You always remember that. So that when you accomplish something, you will understand that it is because of God working through us, not because of our own skill or ability. So, that is the first part. Second, we can see also in verse 1, I think we will not be able to finish verses 1 to 8. But we will only finish verse 1 today and we will continue next week. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God. You see, if you will notice, the word to be is in a parenthesis. It means that it is not in the original. It was supplied by the translator. And they are very honest to put this in parenthesis, telling people that this is not really a part of the manuscript. We only supplied this for maybe the use of language so that people will understand. But the original rendering is Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God. So we can see that Paul is not only a servant, but he was a sent one. Apostle, a sent one. So, the word apostle came from the Greek word apostolos. And it is used 80 times in the Bible. An apostolos was a person sent by an authority with a commission. Like the ambassadors in embassies. They were sent by a country to another country with a specific mission. And that is to represent their country. That is why a cargo ship is called an apostolic ship, because it was commissioned to go into a particular place, a specific place, with a specific cargo. That's why there is a manifest. It is an apostolic ship. If there is no manifest, it is a smuggler's ship, because the cargo is not clear. So the same thing with us. If you went out without a clear goal, then you may be a colorum in the ministry. You do not have the authority, because you need to be sent out by an authority, with authority, to a particular place to do a particular mission or a specific goal or work in that specific destination. So the word missionary came from this word. The idea of the word missionary came from apostolos. So, missionaries are like apostles, but not in the real sense of the word. Because after the death of the apostle Paul, there was no more apostle. But the word missionary came from that particular word. Now, in order to be an apostle, there are things that must be met. so that you will be an apostle. Because in our day, there is a person who is claiming that he's an apostle. And the name is, Fourth Watch, Ferriol. They say that they are the only true church because they are the only church with an apostle. So I was in Santa Cruz and I was in the plaza. We are giving out tracts and we encountered these people from the group of Ferriols. And while we are talking, they're saying that we are the only true church because you have an apostle. You only have pastors in your church, but you do not have an apostle. So I told him, come here. I'm going to whisper to you something very important. And he came near me. And I said, I am Superman. And then he got angry. He says, what are you saying? You say that you're a pastor, but you are, say all of, sort of bad things against me? We are talking about the Word of God, and then you're going to inject that particular thing that is of no significance in the Word of God? Who do you think you are? And he said a lot of things. He said, be quiet. I do not want people to know that I'm Superman. And then he shouted again with a louder voice, and I said, wait, why are you angry? And he said, why did you say that you're Superman? If you're Superman, fly, and I will believe. I said, I cannot fly. So you're not Superman. Okay, when I said that I was Superman, you get angry. When Ferriol said that he was an apostle, what did you do? Did you ask him to prove that he was an apostle? Did you ask him to show from the Word of God that he was an apostle? Do you want me to show you what is an apostle? And then I showed him this. In order to be an apostle, number one, you must be chosen by God. Acts chapter 9, verse number 15. I showed him this. Acts chapter 9, verse number 15. Paul says, but the Lord said unto him, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. In order to be an apostle, you must be personally chosen by God. Personally, you heard that you are chosen by God. I said, when did Ferriols hear that he was chosen by God? He could not answer. I said, number two. Acts chapter 9, verse 6. Acts 9, 6. And he trembling and astonished and said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? And the Lord said unto him, arise and go into the city, and it shall be told thee what thou must do. Number two, in order to be an apostle, you must be personally commissioned by Jesus Christ. That's why the 11, he says, go into the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And the apostle Paul was personally commissioned by the Lord Jesus Christ. So I asked him, when did the Lord Jesus Christ personally commission Ferriols? And he could not answer. And I said, number three, 1 Corinthians 9, 1 and 2. If you will not meet these requirements, you're not an apostle. You are an impostor apostle. Am I not an apostle? You see what Paul says? Am I not an apostle? Am I not free? Have I not seen Jesus Christ our Lord? Have I not seen Him? Hindi ko pa siya nakita personally? Hindi pa siya nakita ng mga mata ko? Are not ye my work in the Lord? Next verse. If I be not an apostle unto others, yet doubtless I am to you. For the seal of mine apostleship are ye in the Lord. So third requirement, he had seen the risen Savior. If you have not seen the risen Savior, you cannot be an apostle. I said, question, when did Ferriols saw the risen Savior? He could not answer and said, number four, Galatians 1, 10 to 12. For do I now persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? For if I yet please men, I should not be the servant of Christ. But I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after man. For I neither receive it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. In order to be an apostle, you must be a recipient of a divine revelation from the Lord Jesus Christ. I said, what did Feriol teach that came personally from Jesus and not from the Word of God? You see, I said, you're unfair. When I said I was Superman, you get so angry and you wanted me to prove that I am Superman. But when Feriol told you that he was an apostle, you did not even ask him to prove that he was really an apostle. You see, that is what we need to understand. We need to know the Word of God. You do not just believe what people are saying. Because I'm a bishop. Why? Yes, the Bible says that you are the bishop of the local church. But they will say, well, no, I have trained so many pastors. Therefore, I am now a bishop. So are you telling that we are now Catholics? That we have now hierarchy? That you are a better person than other people? Ladies and gentlemen, in the ministry of God, all of us are equal. Amen. You cannot be higher than I. And I cannot be higher than you. Because the head is the Lord Jesus Christ, and all of us are under the Lord Jesus Christ. We are equal. So you may be in the ministry for a long period of time. That is why you should show more humility than novices. But it is the other way around. If you have been in the ministry for a long time, it is as if, papunta ka pa lang, pabalik na ako. It is as if because of your experience, you are now a better person than other people. No, ladies and gentlemen, no matter what experience you may have, we only have one Bible and we have the same God and the same Holy Spirit in our hearts. So how can you tell me that you are my bishop and I am under you if we are both a pastor? So tell them, show me from the Word of God that you are a bishop, that you are my bishop. Much more if they say that they are the patriarch. Show it from the Word of God that you are a patriarch in Christian time. A patriarch are those forefathers in the faith that lived in the Old Testament, not now in the New Testament. Because you will never see in the New Testament that it was given to the church first patriarchs. But it says first apostles. And then teachers, etc., etc. But there is no patriarch. That's why if you're a patriarch, you're out of place. You find your place and stay there. Leave the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? So we will continue on verse number 1, the last part of 1, and verse number 2 on Sunday. Amen? So I hope and I pray that we understood the word servant. The take, this is something.